Welcome to Catholic Answers Live. David Matheson sitting in for Cy Kellett this afternoon. Of course, Cy is continuing on the St. Lawrence River, Canada cruise that Catholic Answers is sponsoring. Got a great group, about 150 folks. Chris Check is on that cruise. Of course, Cy and some other great guests as well. Joe Heschmeyer is there. But I am here in the studio today and happy to be here. My normal job is fundraising director here at Catholic Answers. We might talk a little bit about that. It is my job, my main job after all. But more than that, we have 2 hours of apologetics and evangelization. It is an Ask Me Anything About the Catholic Faith for both hours today. And my guest is the great, the only, Tim Staples.
Hey, Dave, it is great to be with you.
The 2 hours? We got 2 hours?
You know, it seems like lately, whenever I've hosted, I get you for 2 hours. And maybe I'm the only one who can handle it. I don't know. It is a great experience. I love being on with you, Tim. You and I have known each other a long time. And, of course, as a senior apologist here at Catholic Answers, this is one of many things that you do. And I know our listeners and our viewers on YouTube as well appreciate what you bring from your long experience as an apologist and as an evangelist here at Catholic Answers. But there's something new coming up.
Yes.
You know, Tim, you're the master of doing many things for a very long period of time that you've been doing, from your parish talks to, you know, the stories of talking with folks out in the parking lot until the wee hours of the morning and discussing apologetics topics. But the new thing that is coming up, and before we get to that, let me mention the phone number to call, because if you do want to get on with Tim, now's the time to call. The lines always fill up fast when Tim is our guest, and they are starting to do so already. If you would like to talk to Tim, the number to call is 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884, and it is Ask Me Anything today about the Catholic faith. 2 hours with Tim Staples. But Tim, you got something coming up called One-on-One with Tim Staples. It is a brand new feature for us here at Catholic Answers on YouTube. Tell me a little bit about it, because I think you've already filmed one episode. Does that sound right?
Yes, we have, and I'm really excited about it. One-on-One with Tim Staples, it's really just doing, as you just mentioned, what I love to do. I love to talk to folks.
Yeah.
I love sitting down. That's one of the beauties of the cruises we do, the pilgrimages we do, the conference we have coming up. It really, I mean, it's great, the talks, everything about it. But I think what's most special is being able to sit down with the folks and you really hear, you get one-on-one with folks, right? And really hear their hearts and you can share yours. Well, that's what One-on-One with Tim Staples is. I am just sitting down, whether it will be in the studio or on the phone, I'm going to be sitting down and talking with the folks. And they can be Catholics, they can be non-Catholics. In fact, we just had our first broadcast helping a young Catholic fellow, sort of a up-and-coming apologist, I think.
Okay.
He was a pretty sharp guy, but talking about Jehovah's Witnesses, how best to evangelize. And he used some experiential sort of situations where he's trying to share the faith with Jehovah's Witnesses. And we talked about what works and what doesn't work. It was great. We've got an atheist coming up who I'm going to sit down one-on-one with and just shoot the breeze. So it's wonderful. And we're going to do all comers, all topics.
Yep.
From, you know, Islam to Hinduism, Buddhism to Orthodoxy, all manner of Christian denominations, and you name it. It's going to be a blast. And so far, we're off to a great start. The first broadcast just went extremely well, and I'm looking forward to the second.
Yeah, and that one actually, I was just told by Edgar in the studio, that's going to drop on July the 20th. So if you're interested in taking part or in viewing the first episode of One-on-One with Tim Staples, July 20th is when it's going to go up on YouTube. But let me tell you something else. The way to ensure you've got a chance to sit down with Tim and discuss one of these topics is to be a Society 315 member. Now, Society 315, of course, is our monthly givers club, our monthly donors club. It only takes $10 a month, but if you are a Society 315 member and you would like to be a guest with Tim Staples on this new series, One-on-One with Tim Staples, All you have to do is email Michelle Murdoch, who is the coordinator for Society 315 for us here at Catholic Answers, and Michelle can send you the application that you have to fill out and go through the process. But if you are a Society 315 member, you have the first crack at being with Tim on this new series. And if you're not a Society 315 member and want to sign up, again, it's just $10 a month. You can go to CASociety315.com. C as in cat, CASociety315.com, and sign up. That is your ticket to get on one-on-one with Tim Staples.
Amen.
Yep, it's going to be great. It's already great because you've already got the first episode in the can. It's going to air here in about 2.5 or almost 3 weeks, and then we're going to get the ball rolling, and it's going to be an ongoing feature for us. I know you're very excited about it, Tim.
Yes, I am.
All right, so we've got 2 hours once again of Ask Me Anything About the Catholic Faith with Tim Staples. The number to call once again is 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. 318-7884. We have two lines open right now, but we're going to get to, let's go right to the phones. How about that, Tim?
Let's do it.
All right. Let's go to Tyler in Brooklyn, New York, watching on YouTube. Go right ahead, Tyler.
Hey, Tim. So nice to talk to you. Thank you for your help.
Yes.
So I'm trying to discern going to a family wedding, and I was just wondering what you would think about if I were to go, kind of how I would go and what I might keep in mind, or if you would advise that I don't go. I've been kind of collecting perspectives from friends and priests, and it's kind of a tricky situation. Some details are just that it's sort of a destination wedding, small amount of people, and it's my cousin who's getting married. And seems really well suited to the person he wants to get married to, but she is divorced civilly, and they're both baptized Protestants, and so was the marriage that she's civilly divorced from.
Right.
So those are the details, I think.
Sure. Well, first of all, for a Catholic, if you're going to a wedding where you have two baptized Protestants, that's the key, that each one of them is baptized, or at least that's the first thing to consider. Because, as you know, if you have one Catholic, that's where you really get the ball rolling towards uh-uh. Because, of course, Catholics are bound by what we call canonical form. So a Catholic that marries outside of the church, that marriage would not be valid or sacramental. And in that case, as a general rule, we say no, we should not attend. But when you're talking about two Protestants, right, you don't have the problem of a violation of canonical form, because two baptized Protestants are assumed when they go into a marriage to have a valid marriage. But now you throw another curveball, because you say one of them is civilly divorced. Well, we recognize as Catholics a doctrine that says, for example, Pope Pius XI and Casti Canubi, Pius XII taught it as well. It's generally understood that marriage is intrinsically indissoluble. And what does that mean? That means, now we're talking about natural marriage here, not sacramental marriage. But on a natural level, marriage is indissoluble, right? Meaning that the couple themselves cannot break that bond. It would have to be a divine authority to do so. Now, in this case, we have a presumed sacramental marriage because you have two assumed validly baptized people. But because you have that divorce and remarriage, that's where your and my conscience comes into play here. Because you and I understand that that person who is divorced and then getting remarried, there's no such thing as a divorce from a civil authority if you have a validly baptized or a couple of validly baptized people marrying. So The key here would be to discover, and this is something I don't know if you can do this, but we can't really do it over the air, because you really have to find out, was she validly married, right? And so in that situation, you and I would be free to go to that wedding, because there is no, you know, there's no requirement for you and I to somehow become a tribunal, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. We don't have that kind of authority. And so when you have a marriage like this, it's, we're not talking about two Catholics, we're talking about two Protestants baptized. One of them has this, that is problematic. You know, unless you know, if you happen to know that she was validly and presumed sacramentally married in her previous marriage, well, then that's when it could become somewhat of a problem for you in your conscience, I think a well-formed conscience. But as it stands, there would be no problem with you going to the marriage and remember, or going to the wedding. But remember, you know, you and I are not required to investigate and do diligence and call the diocese and get a canon lawyer on the phone to find out. These are just, you know, in these situations, unless you know that there is a real impediment involved here and something illicit going on, you're free to go. Does that help at all?
Yes, absolutely, and I really appreciate hearing all of that. I would assume that it was a sacramental marriage in the way that you described it. That's sort of why it's been so difficult to kind of figure out what to do.
So you're saying you would assume that her previous marriage was with a baptized person?
Yes. It is sort of someone who's kind of oddly not too far distanced from the family, from all three families. I do know that. Yeah.
Okay. Well, that is a problem, and that's something that, you know, you have to wrestle with. We don't have legislation from the church that would say no, you're forbidden to go to that union. What we're doing is applying Catholic principles to the situation, mm-hmm. and we have to make that decision. And you're doing the best you can, consulting. You've called here, you've talked to priests and whatnot. And so I think you've got all the facts. I personally tend to be kind of a stickler in these situations, and I don't go. I think it was Jimmy Akin who said years ago, not that this is a canonical principle or anything, but Jimmy used to say, and I think he stole it from Carl, that if God's not going to be there, I'm not going to be there, right? And so, you know, generally speaking, now, of course, that's a bit, you know, facile in the sense that even in a case where you have a Catholic marrying outside of the church, if you have a situation where a family could be destroyed if you don't go and that sort of thing, because there's no specific legislation from the church that absolutely forbids it, even in that case, there can be exceptions. So in this situation, don't kill yourself over it. You do the best you can, and you make the decision. I think from a theological perspective, assuming that we had a valid marriage, she divorced and is getting remarried, you know, that is definitely problematic, and old stickler Tim Staples probably wouldn't go. In fact, I make a hard decision even when it's a family member. If a family member is marrying outside of the church, for example, I simply will not go. But I also recognize that there can be extraordinary circumstances where a person can, in good conscience, attend. Again, when you have a situation where you could destroy a relationship for the rest of your life, perhaps, or even destroy multiple relationships and that sort of thing. Those things have to be taken into account. So I'm not going to, you know, we're not going to give a thus saith Tim Staples, because that doesn't exist. But hopefully you've got the principles to make your decision with.
Tyler, thank you so much from Brooklyn calling in today and getting us started here on 2 hours of Ask Me Anything on Catholic Answers Live with senior apologist Tim Staples. We'll take our first break of the hour. We'll be right back after this.
Catholic Answers Live. Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Magnificat. Published monthly, Magnificat features texts of daily Mass, prayers, articles, meditations, art commentaries, and more, in step with the liturgical rhythm of the Church, on the web at magnificat.com.
This is Father Dwight Longenecker. Catholic Radio helps to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ around the world in the fullness of the Catholic faith, with sound teaching, Orthodox theology, reverent worship. EWTN is doing the very best work we can to spread the fullness of the faith in the Catholic Church throughout the whole world.
The world needs EWTN Catholic Radio, now more than ever.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. David Matheson filling in for Cy Kellett this afternoon, our normal host, and we have 2 hours of Ask Me Anything About the Catholic Faith with our own senior apologist, Tim Staples. We're going to go right back to the phones. Let's hit Nick in Loveland, Ohio on Sacred Heart Radio. Nick, go right ahead with your question for Tim.
Mr. Staples, thanks so much for taking my call.
Yes.
I'm just going to get right into it. So I do have to hang up right after I say, okay. So I'm just going to have to come back and listen to it because I am pushing my break at work. But anyway, so a couple weeks ago, my sister got sick and had to be hospitalized because of an infection. By the grace of God, she's better and at home and doing fine. And my dad was away on a work trip. So it was Sunday, and we usually go to this church in the Madeira area called St. Gertrude's. Has a very beautiful, reverent Novus Ordo. There's tons of people. It's a great church. And
right.
But we weren't able to go to that. So there is another Catholic church a couple miles away from us called St. Columban's and in Loveland. And so I had to end up walking to Mass that day because I didn't have a ride. And I'm 17, and I don't have my license yet. So I walked to Mass, and during the consecration, there were several things that was weird with the consecration, and I'm just going to list them, and if you will just first say everything that was illicit and maybe something that invalidates the consecration. So first of all, it was all glass vessels, not great, and that, I know that's illicit, but the priest said he picked up the chalice off of the altar, picked it off a couple inches off of the altar, said the words of consecration, put it back down. He picked up like this metal platter of host, and he wasn't touching the host, but he picked it up a couple of inches off of the altar and said the words of consecration and put it back down. So I know that there is cases like you don't have to actually raise it up for the consecration to be valid, but he wasn't touching the host. And so I went up and received anyway because I just trusted the Lord that his will was going to be done. And so I have a few questions. First of all, what all was illicit? If anything, did anything invalidate the consecration? Did
right.
I still receive the graces and receive spiritual communion? And then what exactly is spiritual communion? And then my last part of the question, I know it's a lot, so you might not be able to get to it. What do I do? Do I write a letter to the bishop? I am completely lost. All right. Thanks so much. I'll have to listen to this later.
Okay. Well, can I ask one question real quick before you go? Is he?
Okay.
Okay, because I wasn't clear why the priest did that. Was it an emergency situation where they had to consecrate more sacred hosts?
Hmm.
Was that the context? I didn't quite follow the why. And the reason being that generally speaking, well, certainly it would be illicit outside of an extraordinary situation to simply lift up
the paten,
and consecrate and put it back down. But I didn't get the context.
I thought it was just at Mass, because he said they went to Mass at this church instead of his normal church. So I think it was in the context of a normal Mass.
Right.
That's
okay.
The impression I got.
So it's strange what, you know, I'm trying to, in my mind, get to how does this get to this place? Was the actual consecration done without the priest elevating the host at all? That's what it sounds like. He just picked up the chalice. That would be illicit. Now, it would not, I would argue, I don't know of any specific legislation from the church on that, but I do know that hosts, of course, can be consecrated without the priest touching them, because, of course, he only touches the one that he's holding. Mm-hmm. And plus you have concelebrants who just stretch out their hands and so forth. So it would not be invalid. But apart from an emergency situation, I'm thinking of things like plagues and whatnot, mm-hmm. where there would be a minimal amount of the communication of hosts, like we just experienced here in the United States and around the world with COVID. But again, this situation is just so odd to me. It seems to me at least you would have a grave sin here on the part of the priest, because he's not obeying the rubrics. And this is something that is absolutely integrally connected to the most sacred part of the Mass. I think of Pope St. John Paul the Great's great document where he goes over all the abuses of the Mass. And the closer you get to the Eucharist, the more grave is that error. So the priest ordinarily, of course, has to be holding the Eucharist in his hand when he says the words of consecration. But again, I do not believe that is strictly necessary for validity, but it is strongly necessary for laicity. And again, you would have to have an extraordinary situation.
Maybe a physical impediment that would prevent it.
Perhaps. Or, yeah. This is so odd.
Right.
You know, I'm kind of going off the cuff here because I've never heard of anything like this, but certainly, you're not obeying the rubrics in a grave, grave situation. But just touching the chalice, yes, I don't see any legislation that I could think of that would say that would be invalid. Mm-hmm. Because the touching of the Eucharist, I don't recall reading anywhere, is necessary for validity. But again, this is really that's the kind of stuff that the local bishop should be made aware of, unless, again, I'm totally missing the boat here, and maybe our friend didn't tell us that there were some really serious situations surrounding this. That's
yeah,
the best
little,
I can do.
It's a little difficult to discern, right? And there is that moment prior to the consecration where the priest does hold up the paten with the host and ask the blessing upon the bread, right?
Right, the epiclesis.
Right, you know.
Yeah, yeah. That's the epiclesis, which is
we say blessed be God forever if it's a responsorial moment, right? We say blessed be God forever.
Right. When,
and that he's not holding the actual host.
That's right.
But that's, during the consecration.
That's right. But that's not the actual consecration.
Correct.
Because it's when he says, this is my body. And the rubrics say the priest is to be holding it. So that's a pretty serious act of disobedience on the priest's part.
In that situation, Tim, would you suggest that someone like our friend Nick here approach the priest first?
I always do.
Okay.
Yeah.
So priest first.
And really, that's a good point, Dave, because that's a principle that goes all the way back to Matthew 18. And even before that, Matthew 18, 15 through 18, even before that, Deuteronomy 17, 8 through 12, in the Old Testament, you first approach your brother. And that's in the code of canon law as well.
There you go.
You really do, or you really should approach the priest first, because hopefully it can be settled right there, and then you go from there.
Mm-hmm. And then the next step, perhaps, as Nick mentioned, might be
to the bishop.
A letter to the bishop.
Absolutely.
Yeah, great. Yeah. Well, thank you, Nick, we appreciate that call, and hopefully as you listen after to the recording of this, please feel free to give us a call back if you would like to clarify or like some additional information.
Yep.
Before we hit the bottom of the hour break, I do want to draw folks' attention. Tim mentioned this earlier. I think I did as well. The 2024 Catholic Answers National Conference is coming up this September 26th through 29th right here in San Diego. It is the 10th annual conference, and Tim knows because he's been at all 10. I think I've been at four of them. It is a great time. It is a long four-day weekend. It includes Mass. It includes talks by a variety of outside speakers from Catholic Answers, all of your favorite apologists, including Tim Staples, speaking during the conference. There's social time. It is a wonderful opportunity to get together with a few hundred of your closest Catholic friends. We'll share more details on the other side of the break, but if you would like to go to the conference this year, get your tickets at CatholicAnswersConference.com. That is CatholicAnswersConference.com. In the meantime, we're going to go to our first break at the bottom of the first hour. We'll be right back after this. More Catholic Answers Live. Ask me anything.
As we read the Gospels, every Christian faces the question again and again, what does Jesus mean? Getting the answer right is critical to both growth in holiness and fruitful evangelization. Want to know Jesus better so you can introduce him to your friends? Then it's time to get serious about understanding his words. Why not join Catholic Answers for our 10th annual Apologetics Conference? Learn from me the parables, sermons, and conversations of Jesus Christ. September 26th through 29th, right here in sunny San Diego. Learn from our guests, Dr. Scott Hahn and Kimberly Hahn, Dr. Ray Guarendi, Father Sebastian Walsh, Billy Junker, Father Paul Check, and, of course, all of your favorite Catholic Answers apologists. It'll be 4 days of fun, faith, fellowship, and a live radio show. Seats are still available, but going fast. Visit CatholicAnswersConference.com or call 1-888-291-8000 today.
Our Lord needs articulate defenders of the truth to spread the joy of the Catholic faith. Catholic Answers Monthly Giving Club, Society 315, helps you fulfill the call in 1 Peter 3:15 to always be prepared to make a defense for the hope that is in you. For as little as $10 a month, you'll help Catholics grow in faith, bring lapsed Catholics home, and lead non-Catholics to the truth. Go to CASociety315.com and join today.
When it comes to Catholic teachings about Mary, there's one question we hear more than any other. Where is that in the Bible? The answer? Everywhere. In Bible Mary, the Mother of Jesus and the Word of God, Father John Weiss opens Scripture to reveal a Mary who has been hiding in plain sight. Order your copy of Bible Mary today at shop.catholic.com or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. David Matheson hosting the show today, along with my good friend, senior apologist here at Catholic Answers, Tim Staples. I wanted to share just a little bit more information about this year's national conference. Once again, the 2024 Catholic Answers National Conference coming up on September 26th through the 29th. It is the 10th annual conference, and I mentioned outside speakers. Of course, Tim and Jimmy and Joe and Trent and Carlo and Cy, they'll all be there to give talks themselves. But our keynote for the second year in a row is going to be the great Scott Hahn. Of course, Scott is well known. He was a big part of my own conversion from the Baptist faith coming over to Catholicism. Gosh, I guess, what are we talking about? 18 years ago, I think, is when I came into the faith. In addition to Scott coming this year, he was at our conference last year. Dr. Hahn is back this year, and he's bringing his brilliant wife, Kimberly Hahn, as well. She will be giving a talk. Father Sebastian Walsh, who you might know from our book, Heart of the Gospel, Secrets from Heaven as well. He's written a couple books for us. Father Walsh. Dr. William Junker, who is an assistant professor of Catholic Studies at the University of St. Thomas in Minnesota. And Dr. Ray would give me a hard time for saying this, but everyone's favorite Catholic psychologist, Dr. Ray Guarendi, will be joining us as well. Dr. Ray, for a long time, has been a good friend of Catholic Answers, and we are excited to have him as part of our conference this year. The topic is Learn From Me, The Parables, Sermons, and Conversations of Jesus Christ Himself, September 26th through 29th, right here in San Diego. Come out and see us. Get your tickets at CatholicAnswersConference.com. CatholicAnswersConference.com. For more information, call 619-387-7200, 619-387-7200, or email conference@catholic.com. Let's go right back to the phones, Tim. We're going to take a call here from Malachi in Alabama, also watching on YouTube. A lot of YouTubers calling in today. It's great.
Awesome.
Malachi from Alabama, go right ahead for Tim Staples.
All right. Thank you very much.
You bet.
My question was, well, first let me say that I can relate. I can't remember which one of you said it, but that Scott Hahn helped you with your conversion. I read one of his books, Rome, Sweet Home.
Yep.
Yes.
That
yep.
really hit it home for me.
Sure enough.
But my question is, in Matthew 19, mm-hmm. Jesus says the famous words, what God has joined together, let no man separate.
Amen.
And that is one of the founding words for the church to not have divorce under general circumstances.
Right.
But let's see.
And we should add to that, and never is it permitted to remarry if you have a sacramental union that has been consummated. That there is no power on earth, including the Pope, bishops, you name it, no one can separate that. So, yeah, that you're right. Matthew 19:6 is sort of one of those foundational texts. There are others that confirm it, like 1 Corinthians 7:10. But this is kind of the foundational text whereby we believe, and the Council of Trent taught, that Jesus elevated the sacrament of marriage or marriage as an institution to the level of a sacrament. So, yeah, that's a awesome text, but you had a question about it.
Yeah, the next lines is basically the Jesus tells the Pharisees that divorce was made because of the hardness of your heart.
Yeah.
But then he says, I say to you, whoever divorces his wife apart from adultery himself commits adultery. And I didn't really understand why he said that.
Well, you're reading from a very bad translation, unfortunately, because actually that's not what the Greek text says. When he says, whoever divorces his wife, except for, you said, adultery, actually the Greek word there is porneia. It's fornication, not adultery. In fact, there's a, you know, I would guess you're reading a Protestant translation there, and if you look at it in the Greek text, I mean, it's glaring, the difference between the words, you know, fornication and adultery. And that's significant because what Jesus is saying here is that except for the case where there is some grave disorder, where a union did not licitly, or I shouldn't say licitly, did not validly occur. And it's important to note, brother, that this is Matthew's gospel, and Matthew is writing to a Jewish Christian audience, and they already knew full well, they had the concept anyway, unlike our Gentile friends at this time, they understood the concept of annulment, even though they didn't use that language. But you can go to Leviticus chapter 18, for example, and you'll see there are example after example of grave deformities that would cause a marriage to be invalid. And in fact, it gets pretty graphic at times, you know, marrying your own family members and that sort of thing, or entering into relationships with them. And so for his Jewish Christian audience, you'll notice he mentions this in passing because he knows his audience already understands this concept that if, in fact, you have a valid consummated marriage, there is no divorce at all. There's no true separation in the sense of divorce where it is dissolved. However, there are cases where you can dissolve marriages. You can dissolve a natural marriage. You can even dissolve a sacramental marriage if it's not been consummated and there is some defect found. Mm-hmm. For example, in the man, it could be in either, but it's usually the man, where he can't consummate. That can be dissolved by divine authority, the authority of the church. So the key is, if you want to understand this properly, understand the context that Matthew's dealing with this Jewish-Christian audience who understand the concept of annulment. And he's saying, look, the case of porneia, and that is, porneia is often translated fornication, but it can mean any grave sort of defect to something, right? And so this is a case of some grave defect. He's setting that aside as a separate case. But then he goes back to, but if you marry another, you commit adultery, right back to what he had been saying previously. And now, if you look at this in the other texts, in the parallel texts, in the other synoptic gospels, for example, in Mark chapter 10, verse 11, or go to Luke 16, verse 18. In both Mark and Luke, that porneia clause is not there. It simply says, I say to you, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery. There is no porneia clause. And further, I mentioned before, but we could go there now, 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 10. Now, this is extremely important because in 1 Corinthians 7, verse 8, Paul gives us what's called the Pauline privilege, right? And he'll reflect on that as well, down to verse 12. The Pauline privilege that says, verse 12, where Paul really lays it down. He says, to the rest I say, not the Lord, that if any brother has a wife who is an unbeliever, okay, that is unbaptized, and she consents to live with him, he should not divorce her. If any woman has a husband who is an unbeliever and he consents to live with her, she should not divorce him, right? However, if the unbelieving spouse leaves, St. Paul says, the brother is no longer bound. Okay, that's the foundation of what's called the Pauline privilege. If you have, you're in a marriage that is not sacramental, because obviously you have one member that's not baptized, and that person leaves. Now, you cannot leave them. You cannot be the cause of the separation, because then the Pauline privilege does not apply. But if they leave, as St. Paul says, you are free to marry. That's called the Pauline privilege. And notice he says, to these situations, I speak, not the Lord. Did you catch that? Now, that doesn't mean it's not authoritative, because he's an apostle. Right? So this is something he's teaching with the authority of an apostle. So it's something that binds us all, of course. But he's saying, I don't have words from Jesus on this. But look what he says in the next verse. This is in verse 10. But now to the married. Now, what's he talking about? Wasn't he just talking about marriage? Yes, he was, but he was talking about in these less than sacramental situations. So notice he says, now to the married, meaning sacramentally married. Mm-hmm. To the married, I give charge, not I, but the Lord, that the wife should not separate from her husband. But if she does, let her remain single or else be reconciled to her husband, and that the husband should not divorce his wife. Right? And then he goes back to the rest I say, not the Lord. If any brother has a wife who is an unbeliever, and so forth. So he gives apostolically, authoritatively, taught principle, that is the Pauline privilege. But notice in verse 10, and this is what I want you to reflect on, brother, is he's given you the words of Jesus. And so scripture scholars believe, and I believe it's quite obvious here, that here he's actually commentating on Matthew 19, on Mark 10, on Luke 16 to 18, and this very situation when he says to the married now, I give charge, not I but the Lord, the wife should not separate from her husband. If she does, she has to remain single or else be reconciled. And the same for the husband. Why? Because he elevated marriage to that sacramental level back in Matthew 19:6, as you mentioned. Now, unfortunately, the Protestant translations that translate that word as "unless it be the case of adultery," that's just a terrible translation. It's not what the text says. It says, except for the case of porneia. That is some defective situation where you don't have a valid union. He's saying, that's a whole nother case. Now, back to what we were saying. Does that make sense, brother?
Yeah, that makes sense.
All right. And check out those verses. If you put them side by side, it's really apparent. And they go to 1 Corinthians 7, verses 10 and 11, and it'll bring it home for you.
Hey, Tim, on the off chance Malachi is looking at a Protestant translation of the Bible, what is there a certain translation you would recommend that he compare?
Yeah, I would. Yeah. I really like the RSV Catholic edition.
It's a Revised Standard Version.
It's a Revised Standard Version with some corrections in it from the old Protestant Revised Standard, which is a pretty good translation. But there are some key corrections that are made in the Revised Standard Version Catholic edition. It's excellent. And for the New Testament, I also recommend what's called the Douay Rheims. And there's a little bit more of a modern version. It's called the Challoner. It was done by Bishop Challoner, who kind of revised it. In some ways, it's not as good as the old Douay. In some ways, it improves it. But the Douay Rheims, most of the ones you get today are going to be the Challoner Rheims edition. That's what it's called. It was modified back in, I think, the 18th century. But the Douay Rheims has an excellent New Testament. The Old Testament at times is so hard to read. I'd say
because it is a little more archaic in the language, right?
The language is, I like that stuff because I was raised.
There is a poetic nature to it.
There is,
right?
And yeah. I like the old, I was raised on the King James. I like the thithers and withers and these and thous. But those are the two I'd recommend. Check out the RSV Catholic edition, though. It's excellent.
Sounds good. Thank you, Tim. And thank you. We appreciate you calling in today. Malachi from Alabama. Let's go ahead and take our last break of the first hour. We'll be right back. Catholic Answers Live. Ask me anything. 888-318-7884 is the number to call. We'll be back right after this.
Let us help you with your question today on Catholic Answers Live.
EWTN, helping people grow in their love and understanding of God.
I just want to share that 5 years ago, my lovely warrior princess and saint of a wife and I decided to adopt a little girl through foster care. She is the perfect round out of our family of three boys and her. Yes, there are challenges. Very grateful today for all the blessings that he has shown our family.
EWTN. Live truth. Live Catholic.
Who was the first Catholic in your family? Were they evangelized by a friend? A coworker, a stranger? Did you ever think that you could be that person that God uses to save a soul? And that soul could save their family, their grandchildren, and generations to come? At St. Paul Street Evangelization, a Catholic nonprofit, we train, equip, and mobilize Catholic disciples to do the urgent work of evangelization. Catholic Answers is supported in part by St. Paul Street Evangelization, streetevangelization.com.
Matt Swaim here. Tomorrow on the Sunrise Morning Show, we'll get more thoughts on personal prayer from Father Boniface Hicks, and we'll get you all the latest news, weather, sports, and a whole lot more. Now back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live, 2 hours of apologetics and evangelization. Today, our topic is Ask Me Anything About the Catholic Faith, and the number to call is 888-318-7884. All the lines are full right now, thanks be to God, and we're going to get to as many of you as we can. If we do not get to you here in the first hour, we have a second hour coming up. Both hours today are with Tim Staples, senior apologist here at Catholic Answers. So if we don't get to you in the first hour, hang on over the break at the top of the hour into the second hour, and we will do our best to get you on with Tim after that. Let's go right back to the phones, Tim. Let's go to Manny in Sacramento, California, watching on YouTube. Go ahead, Manny.
Yes, thank you very much, first of all. My question is regarding Matthew 27:9.
Oh, yes.
Where St. Matthew quotes from Zechariah, and then he attributes it to Jeremiah, and I think Mark chapter 1, St. Mark does the same thing. My question is it true, because I've heard scholars and apologists say this, which is that it was an ancient Jewish practice. Is there any ancient rabbinical documents that would do that?
Right, right. Well, this is one of those apparent contradictions where you do have differences of opinion between scholars. And so at times, it may be possible that you're correct, that you can have a citation that was made by one prophet, quoted in the tradition as coming from another prophet. I don't have something at my fingertips that works that way. However, that is one possibility. And further, this particular case, if you look at Zechariah 11, 12 through 13, it reads, "I told them, if you think it best, give me my pay, but if not, keep it. So they paid me 30 pieces of silver, and the Lord said to me, throw it to the potter, the handsome price at which they valued me. So I took the 30 pieces of silver and threw them to the potter at the house of the Lord." Right? So it seems like, and sometimes the New Testament writer is willing to string together various phrases from different Old Testament passages and then see them as a single prophecy. This is the take, this is my take on this. And you do have other cases of this, like Matthew's statement that Jesus went to live, quote, in a town called Nazareth. So was fulfilled which was said through the prophets that he would be called a Nazarene. Right? There's no literal prophecy that says this in the Old Testament. You have some things that are close to it, but there you have this quote allegedly coming from a prophet. Now, there are some texts in the Old Testament that come close to that statement, as you know, but it doesn't say Nazarene, it says Nazarite. And so what you can have is a prophecy that contains part, I hope you're following me on this, part of the prophecy is contained in the Old Testament and from a prophet, but another part comes from sacred tradition. And see, and you have to understand, from a Jewish mindset, the ancient Jews were very Catholic, and they understood that there is an oral Torah that is equal in authority to the written Torah. And so you can have a partial quote from the written Word of God and partially a quote that's coming from sacred tradition. And I think that's what you have here. You certainly have the similarities here are obvious. You got, you know, reading Zechariah as I just did in Zechariah 11. You have the 30 pieces of silver, the money thrown in the temple. But notice there are differences. In Zechariah, there's no mention of a field. The money was not used to buy anything, but was thrown to the potter, not the leaders, as in Matthew. These differences can be a clue that something else is going on here, rather than just a literal fulfillment of prophecy. So you have a partial addition here to something that is obviously quoted in the Old Testament. And that would be my take. For example, if you go to Zechariah 11, 4 through 17, the shepherds of Israel, the leaders, failed to do their job. So Zechariah steps in as a kind of sign action and prophesies the coming of the destruction of the nation. The people paid him 30 pieces of silver for his work, the price of a slave, and Zechariah threw it to the potter in the temple, demonstrating their rejection of God as their shepherd. Now, I think we all realize that passages in Jeremiah could also be part of the source of Matthew's citation. in Jeremiah 18, 2 through 6, Jeremiah goes to the potter's house and notes how the potter is free to reshape the pot any way he wished. Likewise, the Lord is free to do whatever he wishes to the nation, including destroying them if they do not repent. Now, of course, in the fulfillment, Judas is destroyed. And you can, you know, go down a litany of examples of how parts, I'll just mention Jeremiah 19, Jeremiah 32, 6 and 7, where you have similar prophecies. And so what may be happening here is you're getting pieces from Jeremiah, pieces from other prophecies, as well as from sacred tradition. And so it's not really a contradiction at all. I hope that helps. It's kind of an involved situation. But whenever somebody comes at you with, well, this is an obvious contradiction, number one, we know from our Catholic faith, and most Christians agree that the Scripture is the inspired Word of God. So we know there's no real contradiction here. So it is good of you to dive deeper, understanding, yes, there is an answer, and there is here as well.
How's that, Manny?
Yeah, absolutely. Amen. Thank you. Thank you.
All right, brother. God bless you.
All right. Let's go to Emma on line six, calling from Hayden, Idaho, and also watching on YouTube. Emma, go right ahead. We're getting a little close to the top of the hour, and we're going to have to take our break at the top. But if you'll get your question in fairly quickly, give Tim a chance to answer. Yep. Go right ahead.
Yep. So I was having lunch with a Protestant friend after Mass yesterday, and she was asking me questions, and I said that the whole focus of a Mass is the sacrifice. And that they didn't have the sacrifice in the Protestant church. But she said, but we do worship, and that's a sacrifice of praise.
Right, right.
So I didn't know what to say to that.
Sure. You're asking the right guy.
Yeah, that's a really, oh, man, this is an important question. That's exactly what I would have said when I was Protestant. Because I said, hey, we offer our own sacrifice of praise to the Lord. But here's the problem. Even in an Old Testament setting, the Old Testament people of God understood the centrality of the temple sacrifices. Even though you have prophecies like Psalm 40, like, you know, many in Isaiah and Jeremiah, Ezekiel 36, 24, Malachi chapter 1. I mean, there's so many examples where they say these sacrifices are not efficacious. And they prophesy about the coming of a sacrifice that is. But having said that, still, I mean, King David, Psalm 27, right? One thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, to inquire in his temple. David, his heart was for the sacrifice and being in the temple and praising God. But you see, the reason why you had to go to the temple in order to fulfill your obligations for the holy days, as they would call them, the yearly feasts, the monthly feasts, and the weekly Sabbath, you have to go to the temple. Why? Because of the sacrifice. The sacrifice is there. And there's something special to the Jewish mind about the sacrifice. So that's why when the temple was destroyed, it was like the Jewish world was obliterated, and they were weeping. Oh, their whole universe was destroyed. Now, God acted in extraordinary ways in that situation with them. But here is the key, and this is what your Protestant friends are missing. Forgive me, I get a little long-winded, but this is so important. All right, is the prophecies of Ezekiel 36, 24, and 25, Malachi chapter 1, verses 7 through 11, right? And many others in the, you know, Isaiah 52, Isaiah 53, Wisdom chapter 2. There are so many prophecies concerning the coming of the new covenant sacrifice. Oh, Jeremiah 31, 31 through 34, right? The coming of the new covenant, which is quoted by the author, the inspired author to the Hebrews twice, in the book of Hebrews, including Hebrews 8, 8 through 12. But what do those prophecies talk about? There's coming a perfect sacrifice, a sacrifice without a flaw. Malachi chapter 1, that is the Eucharist. Apart from which, our sacrifice of praise is essentially meaningless. unless you're in an extraordinary situation, of course. You know, we join spiritually with the sacrifices that are being offered all over the world. But the point is, it's that fulfillment Jesus fulfills when he says, "This is my body," that Paul teaches about in 1 Corinthians 10:15. You know, the bread which we bless is a participation in the body of Christ. The reason why our praises are acceptable to God is because they're being joined with the sacrifice of Christ.
Emma, I hope that's helpful. We'll be right back after this. We've got one more hour, another hour with Tim Staples. Ask me anything about the Catholic faith, 888-318-7884. Taylor, Nathaniel, and Brian, you're up next. And again, we'll be right back after this. Welcome to Catholic Answers Live, your source for daily 2 hours of Catholic apologetics and evangelization. If you are just joining us, you missed a great first hour, the first of two today with Tim Staples, senior apologist here at Catholic Answers. And the topic for the first hour, as it is coming up here in the second hour, is Ask Me Anything About the Catholic Faith. Anything is fair game. You can call us at 888-318-7884. Again, 888-318-7884. I believe we've got two lines open right now, and we've got four callers on the line, and we'll be getting to you folks shortly. In fact, Taylor, you're going to be first up, but hang tight, hang on, because in studio we have social media guru here at Catholic Answers, so I think that's fair enough, Thomas Graff. You know him from TikTok, you know him from Instagram, you know him from all kinds of places within social media here at Catholic Answers, and he has a question coming from social media that he's going to ask Tim Staples, and Tim's going to share his answer.
All right.
Go right ahead, Thomas.
Thanks, Dave. And again, like you said, if anyone wants to see these answers after later on after they've been posted in video form, you can see them on TikTok, Instagram, Twitter, also known as X, and Facebook. I'm trying to get them on all the platforms now.
There we go.
So that everyone can see them. But Tim,
yes.
This person wants to know, can someone, and he wanted to make it clear, he was genuinely curious, not asking in bad faith. He says, can someone tell me what verses talk about saints in heaven interceding for us?
Great question. But I think a little bit of background first. We need to understand the New Testament's understanding of the body of Christ, right? You and I, as baptized Christians, are incorporated into Jesus Christ. And he is the source of all of our life and all of our power in him. And what our Protestant friends often miss is the fact that that power that we have, for example, I can pray for you, brother, and make a difference in your life. Is that because of Tim Staples? No, it's because of Jesus Christ working in and through me. But guess what? That doesn't stop when we die. There is no New Testament verse of Scripture that says, yeah, you can pray and you have all this power as a Christian, but when you die, it all goes away. No, it says just the opposite. In Romans chapter 8, verses 35 through 39, St. Paul says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall persecution, famine, nakedness, peril, or sword? As it is written, we are accounted as, we are killed all the day. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who has loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, principalities, powers, nor things present, nor things to come, or any other thing in the universe can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. So notice, death doesn't separate us from Christ, and therefore it doesn't separate us from each other. This is why in Christ you have text to answer the question directly, like Revelation chapter 5, verse 8, where we see depicted 24 elders. Who are these elders? They are human beings in heaven. And what are they doing? They're receiving prayers coming up from the earth in the form of incense. And God responds as a result of their intercession. In fact, you go to Revelation 8, verses 3 through 5, and you see the angels doing the same thing, receiving the prayers coming up from the earth, from the saints on the earth. The people of God, saints, those who are consecrated to God, using it in that qualified sense, All right. They're full-blown saints in heaven and the angels as well, but they're receiving those prayers. And then notice lightning hits the earth. Lightning and thunder comes out from heaven as a result of these prayers being received by human beings and angels. And there's consequences on earth. We have all over the New Testament examples of this, my friend. Matthew chapter 17, verses 1 through 3, of course, Moses and Elijah appear on the Mount of Transfiguration with Jesus. And what are they doing? Hanging out? No. According to Luke chapter 9, verses 31 through 34, it says they were discussing his upcoming exodus, departure, his death, that he was to accomplish in Jerusalem. So in other words, not only are the saints who have gone before us involved with us, as we see in Revelation 5, and by the way, I would toss in Hebrews 12:24. We don't have time to look at it right now. Hebrews 12:24, and there's a host of other texts that we could look at. But they're involved in the very death, resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that really is what the book of Revelation is all about. It's all about the holy sacrifice of the Mass being said on earth as a participation in what's going on in heaven. And what's going on in heaven is you have the 144,000, right, in heaven. Those are human beings that are involved. You have the angels. In fact, we have in the holy sacrifice of the Mass, doesn't Father say, pray to the angel to take this sacrifice from the altar, or take this sacrifice to the holy altar. We say it in the Eucharistic prayer. That's what you see in the book of Revelation. The angels and the saints are all involved in the holy sacrifice going on in heaven, centered on the Lion Lamb of God in Revelation chapter 5, who's offering himself for all of us, but they're all involved. And so when we go to Mass, we are experiencing not only the sacrifice of Christ, but the prayers of all the angels and saints. So you can literally begin in the Gospel, you can go to Paul's writings, and then launch into the book of Revelation and go right up into heaven, and you see the communion of saints, the saints and angels, and of course, the saints, whether they're alive or they've passed on, whether they're Moses and Elijah or the 24 elders in Revelation 5, they're all involved with us because they are part of us, aren't they? As members of the body of Christ. That's what blew my mind, I'm telling you, as a Protestant. When I first discovered that reality, the body of Christ, we are so connected. I am more connected to my Father right now, who I believe is in heaven. I still pray for him as if he's in purgatory. I'm more connected to him now than when he was walking on this earth, because it's Jesus who makes us one. Does that make sense?
Awesome. That makes a lot of sense. If anyone needs to send that answer to someone else they know out there, it'll be on the social media in a week or two.
All right.
Very good. Thanks for coming in, Thomas. We appreciate that. And if you're not following Catholic Answers on any of the platforms, Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, X, formerly known as Twitter. What else is out there, Thomas? Does that pretty much cover it?
Those are the big four that we're on, yeah, right now. Okay. YouTube as well. You know, I don't manage the YouTube, but we're putting out tons of great content on there,
too. Yeah, you want to subscribe to us
there,
for sure.
Yeah.
Very good.
I would also encourage people to pray a lot more than they spend their time on social media, which I'm working on getting that balance down. But, you know, it's an ideal to strive for, because you need a lot of peace of soul for the amount of time that a lot of us spend on social media.
Especially when you're managing the Catholic Answers social media accounts. There is no doubt about that.
Pray for me while you're at it.
God bless you, Thomas. Thank you so much. Let's go ahead and take our first break of the second hour here. We are in the middle of Ask Me Anything About the Catholic Faith, and our guest is Senior Apologist Tim Staples. Stay tuned. We'll be right back after this.
There's only one Catholic Answers Live.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite monks of Wyoming. Delicious mystic monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All mystic monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase mystic monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
Hi, this is Father Mike Schmitz. Please join me for Ascension's Bible in a Year and Catechism in a Year here on EWTN Radio. We're going through the entire Bible and the Catechism in 365 days, If you've ever wanted to understand what it means to be Catholic and allow those truths to shape your life, this is for you.
Bible in a Year and Catechism in a Year with Father Mike Schmitz. Tonight at 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Pacific on EWTN Radio.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. David Matheson sitting in for Cy Kellett this afternoon, and glad to be here with you. We are in the second of 2 hours of Ask Me Anything About the Catholic Faith, and our guest for both of these hours is Tim Staples, senior apologist here at Catholic Answers and author of many things, including the book Behold Your Mother, which you can find at shop.catholic.com. Let's go right back to the phones, Tim. We're going to go to Taylor in Tampa, Florida, watching on YouTube.
Hey, thank you guys for taking my call.
Hey, Taylor.
So yes. my question is, how can we be sure that the Catholic Church is the true church of history when it seems that the church in the first millennium was governed in a more conciliar way and would seem to be more representative of the Eastern Orthodox Church?
Right. Well, I would absolutely disagree with that assertion that it was more conciliar and in accord with the Orthodox. It was not. Although I would grant you that there was a lot more synodal activity. Oh, I just used a bad word. No, a good word, actually. There was. There were lots of synods in the early church, more so than in recent times, although we're really getting back right now to the early church, the early centuries, right now in the Catholic Church with Pope Francis's synodal approach. But here is the key, my friend. Is that nothing could be further from the truth to say that the early centuries were in accord with the Orthodox understanding. And for those of you who don't know, the Orthodox believe that the ecumenical councils are the only time where the church truly exercises what they would agree is infallible authority. But it has to be. You have to have all four patriarchs there, at least for most of the Orthodox. I know there are some who from time to time try to say they could have an ecumenical council without the Bishop of Rome, but it will never happen because there are too many Orthodox who know history and understand you cannot have an ecumenical council without the Bishop of Rome. And so the Orthodox hold to only the first seven ecumenical councils, and they've had none since, all right? But we understand as Catholic Christians that the Pope has a unique authority on his own. He can speak, as we see from Vatican Council I in 1870, as one man apart from the consensus of the others. He doesn't have to take a vote, Dave, right? Contrary to our Americanistic country, right? He doesn't have to take a vote because he is the mouthpiece of Jesus Christ. He is the vicar of Christ. Now, all the bishops, of course, in union with him are vicars of Christ, and they do speak with one voice, with the authority of the vicar of Christ at ecumenical councils.
And but, a vicar is someone who speaks for another.
That's right. Vicarius in Latin means in the place of. So a bishop is a true vicar for his diocese. He is in the place of Jesus within the scope of authority that he has given directly by Jesus Christ by virtue of the sacrament of holy orders, which he possesses in full. But see, and that's an important point, you know, for our Orthodox friends. We agree that there's no essential difference between any bishops, including the Bishop of Rome. There's no essential difference between the Pope and the bishop here in San Diego when we're talking about the essence of the Sacrament of Holy Orders. They are both bishops. He's, you know, the Pope isn't a super bishop and he gets a special ordination. No, he does not. He is a bishop like all others. However, he has a charismatic gift that is given to him upon his consecration. As promised by Jesus Christ in Matthew 16, 18, he is the head of the apostles, and they must be in union with him. And we could go through all the biblical texts to show that. But to get to your point, Taylor, the fact is, long before we had our first, now granted, some want to call the council in Acts 15, an ecumenical council. We don't traditionally do that because it's kind of a council in its own category because you had the 12 apostles
right
there. And so that it has kind of a special place. But there is a sense in which you could say this is the first council. But the first traditionally understood ecumenical council didn't happen until 325. Now, obviously, the church had already been functioning for 300 years, dealing with all sorts of heresies and errors. And guess who had the primacy all along? The Bishop of Rome. So what I'd like to do is, first of all, send you out an MP3 download of a series of presentations I gave called The Shocking Truth About the Pope and the Early Church Fathers. I go through the first 700 years of history showing how the Bishop of Rome was understood to have the primacy, indeed supremacy, over the universal church for those first 700 years. I don't go beyond that because I think once you get you understand it for the first 700 years, the rest is given. It's given.
Right.
Though certainly we could do that. But here, if you would like, we can send you a copy of that via MP3 download. You can talk to our call screener after I give you this answer. But I do, it's such an important question. Let me toss out just a little snippet of what you're going to hear. You're going to hear a whole lot more when you get the series. And I think it's about seven and a half hours of teaching on this topic. But I start with St. Ignatius of Antioch. Here we have a man who knew the Apostle John, and he was a martyr for the faith. And I'm sure you know, he wrote his famous seven letters when he was on his way to martyrdom. In about 107 AD, he wrote a letter to the Romans. Now, of course, he wrote to the Trallians and the Magnesians and the Ephesians and a whole lot of other uns. He wrote to lots of different churches on his way. But what's fascinating, Taylor, is that you read, like, for example, if you go to his letter to the Magnesians in section 6, when he talks about the bishop of the Magnesians, he talks about he is the authority over the Magnesians, to be expected. And of course, he's very strong, understanding that you do nothing apart from the bishop, talking to those who are his underlings. You do nothing apart from the bishop. And he'll say similarly in other of his letters. But when it gets to his letter to the Romans, his language changes. And in fact, he addresses the Bishop of Rome with all kinds of adjectives, superlatives, and such, and refers to the church at Rome as having the first place in love in the country of the Romans. Notice, the first place, protos. This is a place of primacy, he says, and notice it's in love. Meaning, he's not just over, like the bishop to the Magnesians, over the Magnesians, but now he has the first place of love over all the other churches. In fact, scripture scholars point out that language, the first place in love, no doubt comes right out of John 21, 15 through 17. Remember when Jesus, in one of the many different ways Jesus teaches us about the supremacy of Peter and his successors, the bishops of Rome, he says to Peter, "Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me?" Right? And Peter is shaking. "Well, I hope so," right? "I like you a lot," right? He's, "Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you even like me, Peter?" he says at final. And Peter is greatly disturbed. But what is Jesus doing? He is giving him the first place in love. And that's exactly what St. Ignatius of Antioch refers back to, because, of course, he knew John the Apostle. May well have some argument. I know Tertullian argues he was ordained by Peter. I don't think that adds up. But, you know, according to Tertullian, he knew Peter too, you know. But the point is, there you have in 107 AD already an instance of the primacy of the Church of Rome over all the other churches. And I give you so many examples like this in my series I'm going to send to you. But if you fast forward, I'm going to skip over some of the early examples and get to, in 177 AD, you have St. Irenaeus of Lyon, the greatest evangelist apologist of the second century, neck and neck with St. Justin Martyr. But St. Irenaeus, in his masterpiece Against Heresies, in Book 3, Chapter 3, Paragraphs 1 through 3, he says, in the midst of dealing with all of the Gnostic heresies that were exploding all over Europe and North Africa and in Asia, Asia Minor, all those Gnostic sects that were splitting off and causing all sorts of problems, right in the middle of the document, he says, quote, all other churches must agree with this church, that is the Church of Rome, because of its special place of preeminence. And then he lists all the bishops of Rome from, I think it's Eleutherius who was bishop at that time, all the way, it might have been Soter, but I think it was Eleutherius. He lists them all the way back to Peter, and he says, this is the standard whereby we, that's including him, the most powerful apologist bishop in the world, he says, this is the standard whereby we have received the ecclesiastical tradition and by which the truth has come down even unto us. So St. Irenaeus acknowledges that it is the Church of Rome that has a primacy over all other churches, including him, and they were the ones who settled the disagreements. We could go forward to St. Cyprian in 250 AD on the unity of the Catholic Church, where he uses Matthew 16:18 just like we would today. He uses Luke 22:29-32, right? I will establish you as 12, Jesus speaking to the apostles, I will establish you as 12 rulers to sit upon 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. But right in the middle of that, he says, Simon, Simon, to Peter, behold, the devil has desired to destroy all of you, but I am praying for you, Peter, him alone, in a unique way. Why? When you're converted, strengthen your brethren, right? So we have St. Cyprian in the third century quoting these texts of Scripture, and the whole point of his work is that the Bishop of Rome is the principle of unity for the entire church. And that's what you see from St. Stephen, who was another successor there of the apostles in North Africa, and on down. What I do in the series I hope to send you is I go century by century, and I give you example after example of how, I mean, just look at the, I'll just give you one last one. Look at the example of, it would have been Pope Victor, who over the Quarto Decimum controversy, which if you don't know what that is, that was arguing over when we're going to celebrate Easter. You know, Pope Victor threatened to excommunicate the entire Eastern Church. This is about 190 AD.
Okay.
And you know what? St. Irenaeus intercedes. But nobody says he doesn't have the authority to do it. Irenaeus is just saying, please, Your Holiness, don't do this. You know, this could really be a mess. And thanks be to God, he didn't. But the point is, for those who say the, you know, it was all about ecumenical councils and the Pope did not have any primacy, I'm sorry. They haven't read history very carefully. And I can tell you personally, when I was on my odyssey to the Catholic Church, I tried to be Orthodox. I did, because I didn't like the Catholic Church. I was raised a Southern Baptist. But I got to tell you, it was in my studies of history, reading the Fathers of the Church, that I saw the Bishop of Rome sticks out like a sore thumb throughout the history of the Church, just as Peter does in the Gospels. So at any rate, that's just a snippet, my friend. You'll get a whole lot more when you go through that about seven and a half hours of teaching, the shocking truth about the Pope and the early Church Fathers.
Taylor, hang on. If you'd like to get that audio download, hang on, and Edgar, our call screener, will take your information and get that out to you. Before we take our break here at the bottom of the hour, it's, again, we're in the middle of 2 hours of Ask Me Anything with Tim Staples. Just want to remind you, you might have heard this in the first hour. I'm going to reiterate it now. If you have never been out to San Diego to attend the Catholic Answers National Conference, this is the year to do it. From September 26th through 29th here this fall, the 2024 National Conference entitled Learn From Me. It is the parables, sermons, and conversations of our Lord Jesus Christ. The keynote speaker is Dr. Scott Hahn, of course, well-known Catholic convert, someone who was instrumental in my own conversion to the Catholic faith. And this year, it's the second year in a row he's headlining our conference. He is also this year bringing his brilliant wife, Kimberly Hahn, who will be also giving a talk. Father Sebastian Walsh, the author of a couple of books here at Catholic Answers, including The Heart of the Gospel. Dr. William Junker, assistant professor of Catholic Studies at the University of St. Thomas. And Dr. Ray Guarendi, many of you know him from his show on EWTN and Ave Maria Radio. Dr. Ray, a good friend of Catholic Answers, will be here as well. Again, the 10th annual National Catholic Answers Conference, Learn From Me, the Parables, Sermons, and Conversations of Jesus Christ, coming up this September, the 26th through the 29th. And not only will you hear from all those great speakers, you will hear from Tim Staples, Jimmy Akin, Joe Heschmeyer, Trent Horn, Carla Broussard, Cy Kellett, who am I leaving out? Tim Staples, I think I got them all. But all of your favorites with Catholic Answers are going to be speaking at this conference as well. How do you come? You get your tickets at CatholicAnswersConference.com. That is CatholicAnswersConference.com. And if you need more information, call 619-387-7200 or email conference@catholic.com for more information. One additional point on attending the conference, if you know a priest or a seminarian who would like to come to the conference, I know times are tough, but you know, folks that are in seminary or just out of seminary, they're pastoring their church. A lot of times the cost for something like a conference is not very accessible to them. Keep in mind that at our conference, the Catholic Answers National Conference, priests and seminarians attend for free.
Awesome.
Thanks to the generosity of our supporters. That's what makes it possible. So if you know a priest or a seminarian who would like to come, mention it to them. Have them email us.
Amen.
Have them give us a call. We would love to see. We have a bunch of priests. We have confessions. We have mass during the conference. And it is those priests who come and celebrate those sacraments for us. A lot of seminarians walking around as well. We'd like to see them there also. Stay tuned. We'll be right back after this.
This year, the Catholic Answers Conference turns to the parables, sermons, and conversations of Jesus Christ. Join special guests Scott and Kimberly Hahn, Dr. Ray Guarendi, and an all-star lineup of speakers September 26th through 29th. Spend time with your favorite Catholic Answers apologists and our special guests right here in beautiful San Diego. Seats are still available, but going fast. Use promo code EARLY to save $50 and register today at CatholicAnswersConference.com.
If you're not a Bible scholar, the full message of how the Sunday Mass readings fit together can be tough to comprehend. Apologist Carlo Broussard is here to help. Join Carlo every Friday for the Sunday Catholic Word Podcast. In each episode, he unpacks the scripture readings for that Sunday and brings them all together so you can better understand and defend the faith. Visit SundayCatholicWord.com to subscribe. That's SundayCatholicWord.com.
Is Orthodoxy an alternative to the Catholic Church? In a time of uncertainty for many Catholics, Orthodoxy can look like greener pastures. Answering Orthodoxy, the new book from Catholic Answers Press, explains why Catholics who are thinking of leaving need to think twice. There are important reasons to remain in the Catholic Church and convincing answers to Orthodox claims. Order your copy of Answering Orthodoxy today at shop.catholic.com or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Our Lord needs articulate defenders of the truth to spread the joy of the Catholic faith. Catholic Answers Monthly Giving Club, Society 315, helps you fulfill the call in 1 Peter 3:15 to always be prepared to make a defense for the hope that is in you. For as little as $10 a month, you'll help Catholics grow in faith, bring lapsed Catholics home, and lead non-Catholics to the truth. Go to casociety315.com and join today.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. We're wrapping up 2 hours of apologetics and evangelization, and our topic today is Ask Me Anything About the Catholic Faith with Tim Staples. We've got several calls still up on the board. Let's go right to Nathaniel in Connecticut watching on YouTube. Go right ahead, Nathaniel.
Hi, Tim. Coincidentally, my question is a little similar
okay.
to the last caller's question, but I have a friend who's Orthodox, and yeah. he... refute. It's kind of his interesting take on the papacy. So he acknowledges the primacy of Peter, but he doesn't agree with the primacy of Rome. So
right.
He kind of holds to this idea that there are three Petrine sees, Rome, Antioch, and Alexandria.
Mm-hmm.
Antioch, obviously Peter was a bishop there, and Alexandria, Mark was his disciple, and he was the bishop there. So his argument is that there's no theological reason for Rome to have supremacy. He says that Rome only gained supremacy because it was more politically important in the world at the time. And he kind of says that there should be rather supremacy of all three, in a sense.
Right,
so
right.
So I'm wondering, I understand now, yeah. Obviously, that there's evidence from the early church.
Absolutely.
To say why there's Roman supremacy, but is there a theological reason
sure.
as to why Rome specifically has supremacy over yeah. the other Petrine see?
Yeah, well, the theological reasons are, one, the disposition of Almighty God as revealed in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the will of God walking on the earth, and he is the one who chose Peter, and clearly so. You know, we already mentioned Matthew 16, 18, and 19. We mentioned John 21, 15 through 17, and we mentioned Luke 22, 29 through 32. But you also see in the book of Acts all those gospel passages and more we could talk about. I mean, you have in Matthew's gospel, in Matthew 10, in the listing of the apostles, Matthew just comes right out and calls Peter the first apostle, protos, which of course doesn't mean first chronologically. It means chief. He is the chief apostle. Now, granted, our Orthodox friends will say, okay, we'll give you that first among equals. And I don't even have a problem with that term as long as it's understood properly, because they are equal in the sense that they're all bishops. But they're not equal when it comes to, as I mentioned, the charismatic gift given to Peter and the context of Matthew 16, all those texts that I just talked about with the previous caller, was specifically calling Peter out among the 12 as having a primacy. And in fact, in John 21, 15 through 17 that I mentioned, do you love me, do you love me, do you love me? He then says, feed my sheep, shepherd, or he says, feed my lambs, and then shepherd, poimena, shepherd my sheep. And notice it's arnia are the little guys, they're the baby sheep, right? He says, feed my baby lambs, and then he says, shepherd my sheep, probata in Greek, which is the adults. We're talking laity, we're talking bishops, we're talking everyone. And again, he says, feed my sheep a third time. But the context is Jesus giving Peter his sheep, right? Now, how many of the sheep belong to Jesus? All of them. He didn't give, and this is clear in Revelation here, he didn't give Peter one see. He gave Peter the entire world. And by the way, I'm thinking right now of St. John Chrysostom, the great 4th century patriarch of Constantinople, who says exactly that. He said, yes, James became the bishop of Jerusalem, but Peter was the bishop of the whole world. That was the patriarch of Constantinople in the 4th century. Here, I tell you, from a historical perspective, theologically, you have the fulfillment of the prophecy of Daniel 2:44, that the church would come out of Rome, the Roman Empire, and it would be more than fitting. If it's coming out of the Roman Empire, what city do you think it's going to come out of? But Rome, which is the center of the Roman Empire. So prophetically, in Daniel 2:44, you have the disposition of Jesus Christ in the Gospels, and you have the unanimity of the people of God, as I mentioned, not just through the first seven centuries, but yeah, we had a split, and that is unfortunate. We had a schism. But unfortunately, the masters of that schism were dead wrong, and we are praying that we will be reunited. But the idea, let me just back up for a second, the idea that there are three heads of the church. You know, I remember one of my theology professors when I was in the seminary said, and we were actually talking about marriage at the time, right? The Ephesians, which famously, Ephesians 5:22, right? The husband is the head of the church. And of course, you have lots of feminists who want to excise that from the Bible, right? You know, he's not the head, right? But this professor of mine said, look, in a family, if you don't have a head, you've either got a two-headed monster or a no-headed corpse. There is no other option, right? There has to be a head. Someone, and in marriage we know it is the husband. Someone has to take the head if you're going to have a healthy relationship. This is true in business. This is true in anything in life. Well, so it is with the church, that the church has a visible head. You know, Jesus clearly willed that when he established Peter as the head of the apostles. But here, let me toss this out to you. This is another thing I do in my MP3 download, The Shocking Truth About the Pope and the Early Church. I challenge my Orthodox friends to go to the Council of Chalcedon, right? As you know, was in 451 AD dealing with the Monophysite heresy. And it was Pope Leo who one of the most beautiful, if not the most beautiful Petrine document ever written. And you can get it, you can read it online. I've read it multiple times. It is absolutely beautiful, where he lays out our Christology against all of the errors that were floating around from the Arians to the Monophysites to the Macedonians to the Nestorians. I mean, there were lots of different errors that had been floating around, and he just nails it to the wall. And all the council fathers erupt in unison, and they say, Peter has spoken through Leo. Mm-hmm. The question is at an end. Would to God the heresy would be at an end as well. That's patriarchs. That's bishops from all over the world, and they're rejoicing. But what's fascinating to me is read the letter that was written by the Patriarch of Constantinople. I mentioned St. John Chrysostom before. Peter is the bishop of the whole world, right? Read the letter from the Patriarch of Constantinople to Leo, who was too old, he was too elderly to make it to the actual council, but his legates presided there. He sent a couple of priests, the patriarch writes him, and the letter is so deferential, it says to him. And a little bit of background. After the Council of Constantinople in 381, Pope Damasus refused to ratify it. I don't know why more people don't know about this, but it's a wonderful little tidbit that's more than a tidbit in history. Damasus refused to ratify it because at the council, and Damasus didn't go to the actual council either, but at the council, the Patriarch of Constantinople tried to leapfrog over the other patriarchates and put Constantinople at number two. What's fascinating is nobody denied who was number one. It was the Bishop of Rome. But he tried to leapfrog into the number two spot. And as you know, and by the way, there wasn't just three Petrine patriarchs. There was all four of them, because Peter was the first authority in Jerusalem as well. And then, of course, he was Bishop of Antioch, Rome, and Alexandria. You rightly pointed out he sent Mark with his authority to establish that see as well. So all four of the patriarchates have Peter as their source of authority. That's an extremely important point. But the bottom line is, when Damasus refused to ratify Constantinople, the church goes on. Bishops begged, but he wouldn't, and nor would his successors. Well, here it is 70 years later, and Constantinople had still not been ratified. And so the Patriarch of Constantinople begs Leo. He says, I beg you as a son begging his father, please ratify the symbol of Constantinople. He's referring to the Nicene Creed, right? Or as we call it, the Niceno-Constantinopolitan Creed that came out of 381, had not been ratified. Please ratify it along with the Council of Constantinople, and please ratify Chalcedon. And of course, the Pope did. But the point is, again, as a matter of history, all the patriarchs of the world in the 5th century understood who had the supremacy. They could not have an ecumenical council. You could not have the creed authoritatively distributed to the world until the Pope said so. And this is clear from history. So the fact is, Jesus is too smart to establish a church with four heads, or three heads, or how many heads people want to say. Ultimately, with the Orthodox, everybody's the head. All the bishops are heads, and no bishop has any authority over any other bishop. I mean, you have some titles of honor in the particular Russian patriarch or the patriarch of Constantinople and such, but ultimately, there's no one with any more authority than anyone else, and you cannot have it. It's an incredible testimony to the power of the sacraments, the fact that our Orthodox brothers have all seven of them. They have apostolic succession. That's why they have the power of the Holy Spirit like none other than the Catholic Church, to maintain the tradition as well as they did, even though they've fallen in certain areas, like the Greeks allowing three marriages. And they don't have a universal stand on issues like contraceptives and other very important moral issues. We love our Orthodox brothers, and we're saying to you, my brother, and all, come home to the fullness of the gospel of Jesus Christ that we alone possess in the Catholic Church. And that is not some statement of arrogance. It is simply true that Jesus Christ said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. And his church must say the same thing, that we are Jesus Christ extended into this world. That is the true church. And by the way, St. Paul says as much. In Ephesians 1, 22 and 23, he says, the church is the body of Christ, the fullness of him who fills all in all. It is the church headed by Peter that has the authority. It is the reason, as St. Cyprian said in the 3rd century, the principle of unity for the entire people of God.
Nathaniel, I hope that was helpful. Hang on the line, and Edgar, our call screener, will send you, if you're interested, the fairly
shocking
new book.
Shocking Truth.
Yeah, we can actually send you two things. Send the Shocking Truth of the Pope and the Early Fathers. So that's an MP3 audio download. We'll also send you a Catholic Answers Press book called Answering Orthodoxy.
Beautiful book.
Yep, and we'll be happy to send both of those to get them. You'll need to hang on the line.
That's Michael Lofton, by the way, and he does a phenomenal job in that book.
Very good. All right, hang on, Nathaniel. If you'd like to get those books, Edgar will take your information. In the meantime, we're going to take our final break of this hour. We'll be right back after this with Lisa, Brian, and hopefully we can get to you. If we can, we'll get to you, Matthew, after this.
It's all about the truth. Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
The wisdom of Mother Angelica.
You know, I have never seen women who want to be equal absolutely degrading themselves. And yet the media degrades your nature, your beauty as a woman, your goodness. Let us pray. At some point, our dear Lord touches their hearts.
For more information on Mother Angelica, visit Religious Catalog at EWTNRC.com.
The Catechism defines evangelization as the proclamation of Christ and his gospel by word and the testimony of life. But what does that look like in real life? It looks like St. Paul street evangelists out in the public square sharing the good news. We're a Catholic nonprofit that starts conversations by handing out free sacramentals. Then we employ our method of listen, befriend, proclaim, and invite. Catholic Answers is supported in part by St. Paul Street Evangelization. Visit streetevangelization.com to learn more.
Matt Swaim here. Tomorrow on the Sunrise Morning Show, we'll get more thoughts on personal prayer from Father Boniface Hicks, and we'll get you all the latest news, weather, sports, and a whole lot more. Now back to Catholic Answers Live.
All Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. We are wrapping up today's show, 2 hours of Ask Me Anything About the Catholic Faith, and our guest is Senior Apologist here at Catholic Answers, Tim Staples. Let's waste no time, Tim. Let's go to Lisa in Arizona. Go right ahead, Lisa.
Hi. Yes, I had a concern. I was raised Catholic, and I've been continuing to go to Catholic Mass at times, and I'm also going to a Bible-based church. I have had an issue and a very big problem with, one of the big problems is calling a priest father.
Yes.
It's very clear in the Bible that it says you have one spiritual father. He is in heaven above. I have my biological parent, my father,
mm-hmm.
but it very clearly states to call no man your father, and that honor goes to the Lord.
Okay.
So can you help me on this?
Because absolutely. Absolutely. Yes.
This was one of your hangups, right,
yeah,
Tim?
I really appreciate your call, yeah. Lisa, because I was raised a Southern Baptist. I later became a minister in an Assembly of God community, and this was a big one for me as well. But here's what I discovered, Lisa, upon a little bit deeper study into the scriptures. Yes, you're referring to Matthew 23:9, where Jesus says, call no man on this earth father. You have one father, which is in heaven. Now, he didn't say spiritual father. What he said is, call no man on this earth father. You have one father, which is in heaven. But here's a key that I discovered. You'll notice Jesus also said you don't call anyone teacher or rabbi or leader if you read verses 8, 9, and 10. And yet, we know we have lots of teachers in the body of Christ, don't we? In fact, James chapter 3, verse 1 says, let not many of you desire the office of teacher, knowing you'll receive the harsher judgment. We have Ephesians 4:11, where St. Paul says the Holy Spirit has placed in the church certain offices, apostle, prophet, pastor, evangelist, and teachers, even though it says you have one teacher, who is Jesus Christ. And we could get into leader. You have one leader as well. The same Greek root is used in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 17, that says we are to submit ourselves to our leaders. Same word, okay? But this should be a help, Lisa, to understand that what's going on here is a little bit deeper than just saying the word father or teacher or leader. That's not what's being condemned. What's being condemned is usurping something that belongs to God alone. Now, let's take a look at father in particular. Because, yes, Jesus says, call no man father, no man leader, no man teacher, right? But if we go to Luke chapter 16, verse 24, Lisa, Jesus himself calls Abraham father. He says, Father Abraham, right? That's Luke 16, 24. If you go to Romans chapter 4, verses 1 through 18, St. Paul calls Abraham father 7 times in 18 verses. That's Romans 4, 1 through 18. Go to James chapter 2, verse 21. St. James calls Abraham, guess what, Lisa, right? Father Abraham. And I could give you lots more, but let me just narrow it down to two more. In 1 Corinthians 4, 14 and 15, and oh, I'm so tempted to go to Acts 7, verse 1, and so many other texts. But in 1 Corinthians 4, 14 and 15, St. Paul says, you have 10,000 instructors in the Lord Jesus Christ. You have not many fathers. I have become your father, he says to the Corinthians, for I've begotten you through the gospel. Right? And then Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14, where St. Paul says, for this cause I bend my knee before the Father of light, from whom all fatherhood in heaven and on earth is derived. Now, your Protestant Bibles are going to translate that as the whole family, from whom the whole family is named, but actually the Greek word is father. It's patera patria. There's actually a little play on words here where St. Paul says, for this cause I bend my knee before the Father, patera, of light, from whom pasa patria. See the play on words? Patera and patria, right? From whom the whole or all fathers
are named or receive their power or their authority. And here was the key for me. Right there, what St. Paul is describing is true fatherhood. You mentioned you have a physical father and mother, and so do I. But you know what? I am a father because I participate in the fatherhood of God through a sacrament. It's called holy matrimony. It's called marriage. I'm not taking away from God's fatherhood by being a father because I am in God, and it's God who gives me the authority to be a father in the same way. Now, this can be your physical family or the spiritual family of God. St. Paul is truly a father, not taking away from the fatherhood of God, rather participating in the fatherhood of God and making that fatherhood real for you and I. That's why he could say to the Corinthians, I have become your father. So when Jesus condemns calling anybody father, or teacher, or leader, or rabbi, the context is he's condemning those who are usurping the fatherhood of God, usurping God being the ultimate teacher, leader, rabbi, if you will. But he's not condemning what we teach in the Catholic Church with St. Paul, with St. Stephen in Acts chapter 7, verse 1, and I could give you many, many more. St. John in 1 John 2:13, when he's writing most likely to the elders at Ephesus, he refers to them as fathers, right there. In 1 John 2:13, exhorting them to teach their spiritual sons and daughters, right? So again, the bottom line is, these men participate in the fatherhood of God, as our priests do today, and our Holy Father, Pope Francis, does as well. Can you see where we're coming from, Lisa?
I can see. I still have, reservations about how it's explained and everything.
Okay.
I'm hearing you. And I'm
can you share? Before we go.
I have to digest it a little, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah, but before we go, can you share with me a little something? It sounds like you still have a problem with what I said. Can you give me one such thing before we go?
Well, Paul's not telling anyone to call him father or to call other people fathers. He's referring to them. He's referring to them in that way, that's the role they have, and those are their sons and daughters. But consistently used term, and I do feel that it takes away, I have to read more on what you said.
Yeah, yeah, I appreciate what you're saying.
It takes away from, it's like an intermediary, and it's like, your reverence is going to the priest instead of to God at times. And I can understand where people might be referred that way sometimes, but to be referred to that way all the time, I'm listening to what you're saying, and I'm going to read the Bible more and look into these instances.
Yeah, well, Lisa, I really appreciate that. Check out, like I said, Romans 4, 1 through 18, seven times St. Paul and Jesus in Luke 16:24 and St. Paul in Romans 4 refer to Abraham with the title Father Abraham, as does St. James in James 2:21, as does St. John to the elders of Ephesus in 1 John 2:13. He refers to them as fathers, as a title. Paul refers to himself as having the title of father. I am your father. See, the problem is, And I appreciate it, Lisa, because I came from that tradition. I came from a Baptist tradition that taught exactly what you're saying. But what I discovered is they're taking one verse out of context and rejecting literally 25, 30 plus verses that I could give you that clearly, and in fact, if we want to go back in the Old Testament, we have even more in Isaiah 51, verses 1 and 2, and so forth. And so that's the problem. You got to be careful. If you're going to use one verse to negate like 30 other verses, most likely you might be wrong about that one verse, because God never contradicts himself, and Scripture never contradicts itself. It may be that your leaders over there in that evangelical church don't understand the context of Matthew 23. Remember, Jesus is speaking in the context of where we had an emperor in Rome who was calling himself God the Father. He was Father, and you had to worship him as Father God. And you had some Jewish leaders that were usurping the authority of God, claiming power that they did not have, teaching as if doctrine the traditions of men, as Jesus himself said in Mark chapter 7, verse 6. So it's in the context where you had people usurping the fatherhood of God that Jesus says, don't call any man father. But Jesus would not contradict himself and then turn around and say, Father Abraham, on numerous occasions. So these are things to think about, Lisa. We appreciate your call, and please don't be a stranger. Call again. We love you. God bless you.
Absolutely, Lisa. Thank you so much. And thanks to everybody who called in today. What a great show. 2 hours of Ask Me Anything with Tim Staples. Matthew, sorry we did not get to you today. Tim is on for the first hour again tomorrow for Ask Me Anything about the Catholic faith. And then Tim will be followed up in this seat, well, virtually, by Carlo Broussard, who will also be doing an hour of Ask Me Anything.
Amen.
Thanks, everybody, for being a part of the show today. We appreciate you being with us. Pray for us. We'll certainly be praying for you. God bless.